Life. It's full of choices, busyness, different roads to take, different companies trying to get your attention, to offer you their biggest burger, their newest product. It can be difficult sometimes just to tell whether you're heading in the right direction or if you need to back up and start again. Life is a battle in more than one way. Sometimes you just wish it would stop. But life is also so beautiful. The path may be treacherous, the terrain must be rough, but we know that God is in control. We know that God is greater than.
Hey, thank you so much for tuning in today. My name is Ray Sweet. I'm the lead pastor here. Okay.
Take two.
Hey, thank you so much for tuning in today. My name is Ray Sweet. I'm the lead pastor here at First Christian Church, Greensburg, Indiana. And I'm just excited today to get into the Word of God, but most importantly, let the Word of God get into us and transform these hearts more and more into the image of Christ. Now, I want to start off about a guy who was born in London in 1725. His mother was a godly woman who taught him to pray, but sadly, everything changed at the age of 7 when she passed away. His seafaring father was not a godly man whatsoever, and at the age of 11, his education took a back seat so that he could join his father at sea. At 18, he was forced into service in the Navy, where his wretched behavior learned a few more tricks. In his own words, he said, "I was capable of anything. I had not the least fear of God before my eyes, nor the least sensibility of conscience." See, his seafaring life included being shipwrecked, then becoming a sea captain for the slave trade, where his actions towards those slaves were despicable. In a crazy turn of events, he also became a slave himself off the African coast, where he barely survived with little food and awful treatment. And then one day, as he was trying to signal for help for passing ships by lighting a fire, a friend of his father saw it, rescued him, and took him back toward home. However, they came upon a storm like he had never experienced before, a storm that was jarring them all around, filling their boat with water. And when he thought that there was no hope, they were going to go down in the middle of the ocean, he cried out to that God his mother had worshiped, the God he scoffed at with his lifestyle and his criticisms. And in his own words, he said, "That 10th of March is a day much to be remembered by me. I have never allowed it to pass unnoticed since the year 1748. For on that day, the Lord came from on high and delivered me out of deep waters." Listen, it made no sense. In our eyes, this guy is the last guy deserving of mercy. And yet mercy he got as he repented of his sins, surrendered his life to the Lordship of Christ, and allowed the Holy Spirit to daily transform that heart to beat for the glory of God. And in the words of John Piper, a well-known theologian, if I can talk, he said, "Throughout his 82-year life, John Newton was a depraved sailor, a miserable outcast on the coast of West Africa, a slave-trading sea captain, a well-paid surveyor of tides, a beloved pastor of two churches for 43 years, a devoted husband to Mary for 40 years, a personal friend to guys like William Wilberforce, John Wesley, and George Whitefield, and finally the author of the most famous hymn in the English language called Amazing Grace." And in that hymn, he wrote these words, "Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see." So welcome back to week 2 of our series in the book of Matthew called Greater Than. You can go ahead and grab your Bibles, go to the book of Matthew. You're going to be in chapter 4 today, but we're going to go probably about 2/3 the way through your Bible. That's where Matthew is found. And let's just be honest, life often can hit us like a Mack truck. We all know that. Sometimes it's circumstances that we have no control over that make us feel like we really are going uphill both ways. Sometimes it's my own attitude or my own behaviors that get me into trouble and have consequences. And even when I try to get back on track, Satan's shiny temptations often seem too much for me to resist. And yet, we learned last week that in Christ, we have everything we need to overcome Satan's attacks. We hide the word in our hearts. We call that truth back up, and we are more than conquerors through Christ. And today, we're going to talk about another biggie, that Jesus is greater than my past. Jesus is greater than your past. And here's the thing. Whether you were born in a pew and you have been in church ever since, or maybe this church and Bible stuff is brand new to you. Possibly you're somewhere kind of in the middle. Regardless, we each have a past. We've all gone outside of God's parameters and we've sinned against Him. Do you know how I know that? Because God's Word says in Romans 3:23, it says, "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." That means that one sin causes us to be separated from a perfect heavenly Father whose holiness and righteousness do not allow Him to stand before sin. And yet, He loved us enough that Jesus came into this world to become that ultimate sacrificial lamb that takes away the sins of the world. So, here's an equation for you today. The sinless life plus the cross plus the empty tomb equals the Savior. The Savior who offers us forgiveness and life everlasting when our hearts belong to Him. See, that's what John Newton, a man who admitted to doing some awful, wicked things, that's what he called amazing grace. So, you've got a past. Well, welcome to the club. I do too. And that's not something to be taken lightly. There are some whose pride flares up and they act like they've done nothing wrong. It's always somebody else's fault, right? They can go to Bible studies, they can go to church, and yet the heart is still hard. And each of us have to guard against that. Or maybe you're on the other end and you're hypersensitive to your past and you let it paralyze you. You feel like God could never love or use someone like you. Either way, let's allow that mercy, let's allow that grace of our God to speak into our hearts today as we look at two different passages in Matthew where Jesus calls His disciples to follow Him. All right, so we should be here in Matthew chapter 4, starting in verse 18, and here's what it says. As Jesus is walking beside the Sea of Galilee, He saw two brothers, Simon called Peter and his brother Andrew. They were casting a net into the lake, for they were fishermen. "Come follow me," Jesus said, "and I will send you out to fish for people." At once they left their nets and they followed Him. Going on from there, He saw two other brothers, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John. They were in a boat with their father Zebedee, preparing their nets. Jesus called them, and immediately they left their boat and their father, and they followed Him. So listen, at first glance, without understanding culture, it's almost like, okay, He calls these guys to follow Him, so what's the big deal? But when you understand that in that culture, the greatest job you can aspire towards was to be a rabbi, a religious leader, what we would call a pastor, a preacher, right? And so that was what a lot of young men wanted to be. That's what everyone saw as really successful, that you could be a spiritual leader of your nation. And what rabbis did in this culture is when they were a rabbi, they had to have disciples, guys underneath them, learning from them, just seeing what it was like to be a rabbi. And when you walked alongside your rabbi for maybe 6, 8, 10 years, you learned from them, you saw what they did, you learned to be just like them, to be a disciple. And so you had to come, in that culture, you had to come from the right family, squeaky clean past, be among the brightest, have an extensive education. In other words, you had to be the best of the best to ever hear those words, "Come, follow me." And Jesus, who each of these guys were familiar with, claiming to be the Messiah. And they were thinking, man, this might just be the Messiah. And they later discovered he absolutely was. But he calls them with those same words, come follow me, be my disciple. Young men who did not meet the criteria. And yet, can you imagine being made to feel less than all these years? And now the Savior of the world comes to you and says, be my disciple? Man, that's awesome. And I hope you can imagine it because you have that call on your life as well. So if you're a note taker today, you could always go to the YouVersion Bible app, go to events, go to First Christian Church of Greensburg, but you can go ahead and you can see our outline here today. And I just want to share one sentence with you that I pray God will just use to stir our hearts more in love with Him. And here's the first part. You are saved from your past. You are saved from your past if you belong to Jesus. So in this passage we just read, we see Jesus call two sets of brothers to follow him, Peter and Andrew, and then James and John. These two families even worked together as fishermen. They were very blue collar, rough, tough kind of guys. And so let me just do a quick profile. We don't need to talk about all four guys, but let's talk about one from each family, okay? First, you have Peter. A lot of us can relate to this guy. Peter's a big, bold personality. He's brassy. He's blue collar, fisherman. Let's put it this way. His mouth often wrote checks his behind couldn't cash, okay? And as we read through the Gospels, we see a man who's impulsive, who's hot-tempered, who's cowardly. And I wouldn't be shocked if Peter, by the time he met Jesus, had probably been in 50 fights in his life, probably lost over half of them, okay? And we even see him as a disciple who had witnessed the miracles of our Savior. And he says, Jesus, I don't care what the rest of these cowards do. I will never deny you. And then when push came to shove, he denied knowing Jesus three separate times. Now, we're not done with this guy, and neither is God. But let's move on for now and talk about John. John was also a fisherman. But we get the idea here that he came from maybe a little more well-to-do family, that in that business, it says they owned their own boat, so that was usually a good sign. Also another indicator, they had hired servants who worked for them. And Jesus nicknamed John and his brother James the Sons of Thunder. Now, they must have been pretty wild, and we see a man who could be vengeful and fiery, selfish, judgmental, even lack a servant's heart. He wanted to sit on Jesus's right or left in heaven, but he didn't want to be the servant it took to get there. And once again, God's not done with this guy, but let's look at another profile real quick and we'll come back. Flip a few pages with me, if you would, to Matthew chapter 9, verse 9. And let's look at a guy named Levi, aka Matthew, as Jesus calls him out of the tax collector's booth into a life of grace and purpose. Here's what Matthew 9:9 says. As Jesus went on from there, he saw a man named Matthew sitting at the tax collector's booth. Follow me, he told him. And Matthew got up and followed him. Now, what a cool passage once you understand the culture, okay? Now, in our culture, no one's jumping up and down about an IRS worker, especially this time of year at tax time. But hopefully, no one's looking to slash their tires either. But this was different because in the first century Jewish culture, tax collectors were lumped together. They were seen as bad as prostitutes, murderers, robbers, unbelievers, and they were usually just called sinners. Here's why. With Israel being controlled and taken over by the Romans, the taxes on transported goods that came in were contracted out to locals. So guys like Matthew would pay Rome an agreed upon sum for the right to collect taxes, and then they were allowed to charge just crazy amounts, getting very wealthy in the process. And you could do nothing about it, okay? Other than exactly what Jews did. They hated tax collectors. They refused to include them in society and often gave them the what for anytime they could. So they were hated for two big reasons. The corruption, number one, and number two, you're a Benedict Arnold. You're a traitor against your country, working for the enemy. And what does Jesus do? He calls one of those very outcasts to be his disciple. This was radical and it was divinely intentional. And it should give you great joy today because we too have a past. We've made mistakes. We've sinned against God. We've wallowed in our addictions and our pride, even our selfishness. And yet, Ephesians chapter 1 puts it like this. In him, in Jesus, we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins in accordance with the riches of God's grace that he lavished on us. So if you're a child of God today, and it takes you making that commitment to accept the grace of God, to repent, to be baptized into Christ, but just like John Newton, we can say that, man, I was a wretch. And yet because of Jesus, I could boldly proclaim amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Guys, I am so thankful for these examples in Scripture of God not always choosing the best of the best, but taking flawed, jacked up sinners and washing them clean by the blood of Christ. And there's nothing he delights in more than to seek and save the lost, because Jesus is greater than your past, no matter what it is. So if you're a disciple of Jesus today, you can boldly proclaim these words from Corrie ten Boom. I know beyond a shadow of a doubt, my debt of sin has been wiped out. Now, if you've been in church all your life, I want to squelch something that's absolutely false. Maybe you've been a follower of Christ since you were a kid. Maybe you've not hit rock bottom like maybe others have. I need you to hear me. I know sometimes others have maybe made you feel like you don't really have a testimony. You don't really have a story. That is a lie straight from Satan, because you have walked a road. You have sinned against God. You have a story of redemption where he has changed your life, and God specializes in putting people in your life for you to share with. And I dare you to ask him to put the people he wants in your path. And then there are those who maybe have a big testimony. You've hit rock bottom. You understand what it is not to have God in your life whatsoever. And the Lord has brought you out. Praise him. Use that story. Don't brag about it. It's nothing to brag about. But realize God has brought you out of that, and you can share that with others, what he has done. Because if your heart belongs fully to Christ, you are saved from your past. Now, let's finish this sentence today. So you are saved from your past. Doesn't matter where you've been, what you've done. You are saved from your past when you're a child of God. But you're also empowered for a purpose. John Newton, the man who was once a vile slave trader, mistreating, causing hopelessness to so many, was now forgiven. He was now transformed, even preaching the gospel as a joyful pastor, a gentle husband, a faithful friend, and just a vessel of hope to those around him. And as great as that is, God doesn't just want to save you. He wants, just like with Newton, to empower you for one of the very purposes you were created for. And that is to use your unique personality, giftedness, and passions to serve him. So let's go back to Matthew 4:19. It says, come follow me, Jesus said, and I will send you out to fish for people. Some translations say it like this, I will make you fishers of men. And I love how Jesus met these fishermen right where they were. And while there was nothing wrong with their profession, okay, Jesus basically says, hey, yeah, fishing's fine, but I have a greater purpose over your life. You know all about fishing, so how about we go fishing for some people to come to know me as Lord and Savior, Jesus says. Now, later in Matthew 9, in verse 37, it actually says this, and this is Jesus speaking to someone right in their context as well, and to farming people. He says this to those who are in farming. He says, the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into the harvest field. Now, let's go back to our profiles from earlier. We mentioned the sinful behaviors of Peter, John, and Matthew. But look at what happens when God got a hold of people who are all in. Peter goes from this big, brassy, all-show, no-go personality to a man who's sold out for Christ now. That boldness has had a huge helping of humility added to it, and he begins to be used for the kingdom of God as he stands up as the leader at Pentecost and preaches the word alongside his brothers, and 3,000 were baptized that day into Christ. He continues to mature and grow as he becomes one of the pillars in the Jerusalem church. He writes the books that God inspires through him of 1st and 2nd Peter, and eventually he gave his life to tell the world about Jesus. John goes from vengeful, fiery, selfish, judgmental, to bold, loving, compassionate. Jesus entrusted John to take care of his mother Mary. He preached and healed in Jesus' name. He wrote, God used him to write the Gospel of John, 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John, and even shared a great revelation with us that we call the Book of Revelation. And he'll go down as the one apostle not to be killed for his faith. And then there's Matthew. And we see the instant transformation in Matthew 9, verse 10, right after Jesus calls him from that tax collector booth. It says this: while Jesus was having dinner at Matthew's house, many tax collectors and sinners came and ate with him and with his disciples. When the Pharisees saw this, they asked his disciples, "Why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners?" On hearing this, Jesus said, "It's not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick." So not only does one societal outcast come to know Jesus, which is awesome, but the rest of his friends have the same opportunity, and he is used by the Lord to share Jesus with them. And while the Bible's a little quieter on what happens to Matthew from this point on, we know, according to tradition, that he preached in several areas, wrote the Gospel of Matthew. That's not tradition. We know that from reading the book of Matthew. And then he gave his life shining for Jesus. Now, I don't share about these three guys today to put them up on some kind of pedestal. Okay? I share their story to say, listen, we're just like them. We're human. We've sinned. And yet, he who is in you is greater than he who is in the world. And I love these words inspired by the Holy Spirit that Paul spoke. And if you think about Paul's story, this guy fits the bill as well. He hated Christians. He persecuted them with zeal. And yet when he came to know the grace of God, everything changed. And he could write these words from Ephesians 2:10. For we are God's masterpiece. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus so we could do good things he planned for us long ago. Now, I bet you, some of you, and if you're a part of our church family, I don't know if you are or not, but I'll tell you, in our church family, we have some incredible believers who love people, who are very relational naturally, people who can have a conversation with anyone and make them feel comfortable. Can I tell you something I hope that we never are as a church? I never want to be a church where we are just cliquish and ignore visitors as they walk in the door. Everyone kind of snubs their nose and no one seems to notice or care about others among them. I pray that that is never us. So for all of us, we can be friendly. We can realize, listen, even when you come to church on a Sunday, man, that's a mission filled as well. But especially for those of you who love to get to know new people and who are a little bit more adventurous, you don't realize that your smile, your conversation may be what brings someone back. It may be what gets someone involved in a church family. And ultimately, it may be what brings them to Jesus and changes everything about their life and their family tree. If that's you, keep greeting at the door, in holy grounds, in the parking lot, or just as you walk past those made in the image of God. Or maybe you take those gifts where you love people, you care about their salvation, and you add that adventurous spirit in, and man, you go on mission trips. We just had a team come back from Guatemala, and it's awesome to see what God can do. Now, others of you, you're the more creative types. Whether that's music or art, design, decorating, planning, the list goes on, but God can empower that gift for his glory. Could you imagine if we didn't have our praise team each week on Sunday morning? Worship music could be rough, especially if you're expecting me to take over. We all know I can't sing, okay? But I'm thankful that they lead us to the throne in worship every Sunday, that they do it with excellence. And then there's the super detailed people among us who are sometimes can get a bad rap for being so particular. But when you come in on a Sunday, you can tell that they've been hard at work because things are going to look nice. You're going to feel welcome. The property is going to be welcoming as you come in. It's going to be done well. Connection Point is going to be organized and helpful. Holy Ground food is going to be ready to be served. We're going to be great stewards of our finances. Announcements are going to be clear and well done, and distractions are going to be eliminated so that you can come to know Jesus or grow deeper in your walk with Him. Others maybe in our church claim to just be worker bees, and that's awesome. We need those. Can I tell you that right now we are worshiping in our contemporary services over in the Family Life Center, and that means we set up or tear down about 4 times a week. It's a lot of work. What a blessing for those people who can see a need and jump in and set up or take down chairs. What a joy for those who have the gift to cook or even help serve with meals. And listen, we didn't even mention children and youth workers who are a glutton for punishment, but wow, do they love the Lord and lead our children and our youth to Jesus? And I'm sure there are so many areas that I just can't mention today, but I am so thankful for God's grace that He freely offers to you and me today. I'm grateful He didn't just save us to just sit us in a pew, to be a consumer. He saved us so that we could grab our towel and serve with enthusiasm so that we could impact the kingdom of God. And just like John Newton, if we are in Christ, we have the ultimate hope. There's hope right now on this earth, and I cling to it every day, but there's a hope even greater, an eternal life in paradise. And we can say these words with joy when we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we've no less day to sing God's praise than when we've first begun. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. So if you hear one thing today, it's simply this: Jesus is greater than your past, and He has an awesome future. Walking in Him every day, being used for His glory. Pray with me. Father, thank You for Your word today. Thank You for how You've spoken right into our hearts, right where we need it. And Father, I just pray over anyone watching this that they will know that there is forgiveness of sins. It doesn't come automatically because You give us free will. But Father, when we repent, when we believe, when we confess, and we are baptized into You, You give us the gift of the Holy Spirit, and we walk in Your power and Your strength every day. So thank You for this amazing grace, as John Newton called it, and help us to walk in a way that is worthy of our calling. We love You, Jesus. Thank You for Your word. We pray all this in Your precious name. God's people said, amen and amen. Hey, you noticed in that story, it said that Jesus said, come follow me. And the guys did not say, well, can I have a week to pray about it? They didn't say, well, I need to finish this. I need to do this. What did it say? They got up immediately and they followed Him. So maybe that's where you are right now. You're starting to realize that, wow, God is pursuing me. He wants to forgive me. I can be forgiven no matter what I've done. Well, listen, His arms are open wide and He says those words to you, come follow me. But you got to make the decision to get up and say, okay, here I am. I'm all in. And so we would love to come alongside you and talk that through with you, show you what God's word teaches. So please reach out to us in a couple different ways. You can call the church office, First Christian Church, Greensburg, Indiana, 812-663-8488, or you can email me at ray@fccgreensburg.com. Hey, God bless you and have a great week.